your very amazing question.
Okay, Janelle. So, what do you expect to get from this interest-based MEAster class?
I hope to learn more about stocks and investment, you know, and expand my knowledge and hopefully be able to apply it, you know. Yes.
And you will definitely learn all that here because, you know, we have very amazing speakers. Grabe. And, you know, did I forget to mention, they're also very hot. Grabe. So it's like Selecta, you know, 3-in-1 plus 1. But anyway, yeah, let's wait for more participants to come. So yes, kindly settle down, everyone. Keep it. I think I'm coming alive, yeah. I'll come alive with you. Don't give it up. Don't say it hurts. Cause another life that's been on, baby, now that I found you. I want it all. No, there's nothing like that's been on, baby, now that I found you. Now that I found you. Alright, Aaron, I think before we start, we have to, you know, share some of the rules and regulations.
Alright, guys, 5 minutes left until we start stonking. Here are a few reminders before we begin. Number one, please mute your microphone so everyone can focus on what our speakers are saying. However, we encourage you all to keep your cameras on if you feel comfortable.
And number two, kindly double check your audio if you can hear our very, very wonderful voice. So if you can't, then press on the connect computer audio button found at the bottom left of your screens.
Yes, number three, if you get disconnected at any point during the talk, just message TJ Cruz at 0917-320-0209 or Facebook Messenger to receive assistance in rejoining the Zoom call.
Yeah, if I were you, I would slide into her DMs now. Pero anyway, number four, if you have any questions, you can kindly send it at www.slido.com at any point throughout the talks. So the event code is hashtag stonks, you know? So don't worry, your questions will be sent anonymously and will be answered during the Q&A portion of this event.
Number five, we will be recording this session so that we can send it to those who could not make it.
And last but not the least, number six, don't forget to enjoy this very value-adding workshop brought to you by HRTD. Yon. Okay, Aaron, I think it's time. So...
Okay, it's good now afternoon. Time.
Okay, it is now time. So, good afternoon, everyone. I am Mark Phoenix D, your local James Reed. No mukhang galing Bilibid from 1BSME.
And I am Aaron Lampangan, your bobong course mate na bobo sa buhay mo from 1BSME. And welcome, everyone, to this year's very first interest-based MEAster class, Stonks Edition.
So, first of all, on behalf of the HR training and development team, kaya nga HRTD, diba? Grabe. I'm so big brain. We would all like to thank each and every one of you for coming.
We are so excited to learn about making money with all of you. But first, Mark, do you know what an interest-based MEAster class is?
Well, Aaron, I think it's an initiative of HRTD that aims to provide us Mayans with more accessible opportunities to learn. And with interest-based MEAster classes, their goal is to assist you with skill-enhancing avenues that are based on your specific interests and skills.
Well, Mark, that sounds pretty lit and value-adding. See, I'm so cool. I know the cool words lit, you know. Okay, people, for the next 2 hours, we'll be learning all about interest, stocks, and how to obtain that grain.
Indeed. So we'll be hearing from not one, but two speakers today. So yes, so they'll be sharing the how-tos and the know-hows of the stock market. Then afterwards, we'll be having our very own workshop session where you guys will get the chance to have a little taste of what it's like to be a stock master.
First of all, let's introduce our esteemed speakers for today. First, we have BJ Imperial, a BSME graduate of 2020 from the Ateneo de Manila University. In his college years, he was a part of MEA from 2016 up to 2020 and was a co-head of Trade City, an event designed to impart knowledge in investing in stock market trading. Since then, he has entered as a research analyst at CTS Global Equity Group, has been an active equities investor from 2018 up to the present day, and is currently a global equity analyst at Cedarside Investments LTD. BJ also plays ice hockey and has participated in major sporting events like the SEA Games. So as you can see, he's so good at ice hockey, he can play on the sea. Oh my God.
Grabe pa mo yun, Aaron. Di ko kaya yun. Pero anyway, Aaron, let's move on. Kahit di mo mag-move on. So next, we have our second speaker. We have Lance Lee Sunga, also a BSME graduate of 2020. Then from he's also from the Ateneo de Manila University. Grabe, that school talaga. It's so good. And he's also been a part of MEA daw from 2016 up until 2020. And he's been an active investor in the stock markets ever since his college days. But wait, there's more, you know. Currently, he's a global equity analyst at Cedarside Investments LDD with a focus on the United States, Japan, and the Hong Kong equity markets. Grabe, this guy, Mr. Worldwide. Pero wait. There's more talaga. Grabe, so much info. In his free time, Lance actually likes to play video games. Pero don't worry daw kasi he won't play with your heart. Grabe, akin ka na lang, Lance. That's right. Lance is single and very, very much ready to mingle. Plus, he produces his own music.
Grabe naman yun, Mark. Today, our speakers will both be touching on the fundamentals and analysis of stocks. First, they'll be talking about Stocks and Investments 101. I can't wait to hear what they have to share. So without further ado, let's give BJ and Lance a very warm welcome.
Hello, everybody.
Hello.
Thanks for coming to our talk. Please bear with us for the next few hours.
Okay, so let me share my screen. You guys can see the screen. So good afternoon again, guys. I hope you're all doing well. And thank you to the organizers for inviting us to share to you guys a very special topic, which is stock market investing. Right. And so let me start. So first question is why? Like, why should you invest in the stock market? And this data here says it all, right? Stocks have outperformed other asset classes such as government bonds and P2 savings, and most importantly, inflation, right? But what's so special about stocks is that the 8.6 annualized returns, it's not the limit for stocks, right? This 8.6 annualized returns can go up to 10%. 20%, 50%, and even higher, right? But let me remind you that it's not easy, right? Very complicated in the stock market. And you probably heard other people say how, you know, the stock market's just another form of gambling, right? And it's true, because there's really no guarantee whether you'll win or not, right? But today we're gonna share to you guys the rules and the mechanics of the game and how the game works so that you guys can consistently win in the stock market. So first off, what is a stock? So a stock is a representation of ownership, right? Of a fraction of a company. And every company has their own stock. But only if the stock is publicly listed would you be able to buy its stock. So for a company like Ayala Land, who is publicly listed, you can buy its shares, right, in the stock market. And so how does stock price go up? in theory, fair price of a stock should track the company's earnings. A stock price should appreciate or depreciate depending whether a company performs well financially. Right. But in reality, a stock never really goes straight in one line, just like this. Right. It fluctuates. And the reason behind that is because there are other factors that come into play, such as market perceptions, people's expectations, and people's emotions. And so with this in mind, we need to have a framework. We need to have a set of rules for us to follow in order to increase our probability of winning the game. Right. So first, we have to pick a character in the game. And there are two characters in the game. First, you have the stock investor. And second, you have the trader. And the differences of an investor and a trader is first, their risk profile. The stock investor is generally more risk averse compared to the trader, who is more of a risk taker. The stock investor, the second difference is also in their time horizons. Stock investor has a longer time horizon. Usually they hold the stock or they buy the stock and hold it for months and years, compared to the trader who will just hold it for weeks, days, sometimes even minutes or seconds, right? And lastly, their differences would be in their strategies that they use. For investor, they use a passive and active investing strategy. For the trader, they use either trend trading strategies or counter trend trading strategies. So let me give you an example, right? For a stock investor, his trades could look like this. So this is SM Investments over a 5-year chart. And an investor could make an annual investment of 100,000 pesos at the start of each year. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 investments over 5 years, right? At an average price of 815 pesos. And the price of SM today, or at November 23, was 1,080, which is 32% up from his average price of 815. And this translates to 160 pesos in returns. Now, for the trader, on the other hand, this is the same stock, SM Investments, but this time it's over a 1-year. And so you see there's more trades in a shorter time frame for a trader. Right? There are 7 hypothetical trades that a trader can use, and it translates to a 27%, right? And you see how it can get a bit complicated for the trader, right? It's definitely much more easier work for the investor, as he basically just buys a stock for once a year and he sees a return of over 32%, right? And I personally think that being able to solidly define your character from the start would increase your chances of winning substantially, right? I mean, you can't be an archer but use a sword, right? I mean, you can, but what are your chances of winning, right? And so, you know, it's of course it's good that you explore these two characters, but at the end of the day, you have to really just choose one, because otherwise you're gonna get confused with your strategies, right? And it would lead you to lose money. Now, since you know the characters of the game, let's move on to the rules of the game. And the rule that we use, or the framework that we use, is called the FTSR. The FTSR stands for Fundamentals, Technical Sentiment, and Risk. And this framework was made by the Calum Trading Institute, which is our sister company. And this is the blueprint that we use for every of our single trades, right? And just to explain the scale right here, fundamentals and technicals should be balanced, should be equally balanced, right? And you have to understand that the beam, which is sentiment, and the base, which is risk or risk management, are equally important, because without them, your fundamental analysis, your technical analysis will fail. So first off, what is fundamental analysis? Fundamental analysis is basically the study of the company's four P's, right? And the four P's stand for people, product, potential, and predictability, right? And so for people, we ask, who are the people behind the company, right? Who are the board of directors, and who's the management team leading the company? For product, what is the business model of the company, right? Does the company have a competitive advantage? And if it does it have an ability to maintain it, or something that we call a moat? For potential, right, what's the possibility of growth for this company? If the company is currently profitable, does it have room to grow more? If it's not profitable now, will it be profitable later on? Right. And for predictability, we have to identify where the company currently is at its corporate life cycle. So what is the corporate life cycle? So basically, a business has six stages in its lifetime. We have startup, young growth, high growth, mature stable, and up to decline. And how predictability works is basically, for example, a startup, right? You expect a startup to just really burn through a lot of cash, right? Whether it be through investments or R&D, right? And you don't know whether it would be able to leap to the next stages, to young growth and to high growth, right? And so the predictability of a startup, right, it's very low, right? You can't really predict how it's gonna perform at all in the future. But for a company who is in its mature growth, a mature stable stage, it's easier to predict the company on what it's doing or its business decisions. When this pandemic hit, right, a lot of these criteria were violated. And so the approach that would be best to use during, for example, the pandemic or any other crisis, is to basically use a top-down approach. And basically the question here is, are the company's product and services essential or non-essential goods? So just a quick example, we have Cebu Pacific here, and we have PLDT right here. And obviously we know that airlines were prohibited, right, during the lockdown. And everyone was using Wi-Fi, or they needed to use Wi-Fi. So it's very clear here what is the essential good and what is the non-essential good. And it reflected in their stock prices, right? The Pacific crashed and didn't go up. But PLDT, right, it quickly recovered after a minor crash. So moving on, technical analysis. So what is technical analysis? A lot of people, right, they usually think of technical analysis as identifying pattern trends or candlestick formations, right? And it is true in a sense, but the best approach to technical analysis is by asking why it works. Not asking how it works, but why it works, right? And we mentioned a while ago that because of different market perceptions, expectations, and emotions, the market fluctuates, right? The market fluctuates. And so this is why technical analysis works. It's because these fluctuations produce your chart patterns and your candlestick formations, right? So it would be best for you to understand that part first. So let me give you an example for you to understand this better. Right? So one of the most basic ideas in technical analysis is understanding support and resistance lines. So a support line, and let me draw it right here. So basically a support line is the price at which people are willing to buy the stock for. And same goes for the resistance line right here. But this time it's the price at which people are willing to sell the stock for. And what this basically means is that when your price breaks out, when it breaks out of your resistance line or breaks down of the support line, right? It usually indicates that people see the stock as undervalued if it breaks out or overvalued if it breaks down. And in the case of the stock Semirara, right, the stock broke out because people think that, hey, the stock might be undervalued, right? Prices may be cheap, right? That's what they think, which is why it broke out. And remember, this is people's emotions in play, right? They think that it is undervalued. They think that it is cheap. It can be actually cheap or not, right? And so it broke out, and after a few days, the price proceeded to form an uptrend, right? And just by understanding, right, this fundamental concept, right, you really didn't need to like study the patterns and the formations. And you just did a quick technical analysis just by using this support and resistance line, right? And this could really help with your technical analysis and help you identify strategic entry and exit points, right? Rather than studying a bunch of different patterns and formations. Right. For example, this one, this stock, it has how many other chart patterns and formations, right? You have one right here, another one right here, another one right here, another one right here, but all of them are just basically saying the same thing just by using a support and resistance concept, right? So I hope you guys understood that. Technical analysis, it's really complicated. So hopefully you guys understood it. And then moving on, let me do this first. So moving on, we have market sentiment, right? And market sentiment refers to the overall psychology of the crowd, the general sentiment of the crowd. And it's determined by fundamental and technical factors such as price history, economic reports, seasonal factors, political changes, and world events. And it basically points to where the money is flowing to, right? whether it be through stocks or through bonds, or through commodities, currencies like your dollar, etc., etc. And this is very important because you do not want to fight the tide at any cost, right? If you look at the PSE crash, the market crash this year, right? The sentiment during this time was very bad, right? People were saying how vaccines would be coming a year later or even more, right? And so this consequently would make people's lives harder to recover. Businesses would not recover at all, right? Countries, economies at the same time. And the sentiment here was very bad. And to be buying the stock right here when you think that it's cheap, right? It's going to be very hard for you to translate this into gains or earnings, right? Because if you thought that the market already bottomed right here, right? You were wrong, or even here or here, right? Maybe if you're lucky and timed this well, but not everyone's lucky, right? And it's very hard. I'm not saying it's impossible, right? But it's very hard to fight the tide. And lastly, we have risk, right? Risk is all about managing your upside and your downside, right? And this is through first proper sizing. Proper sizing is basically how much of your total portfolio are you willing to risk? And it's also by setting target prices when the stock goes up and setting a cut loss when the stock doesn't go your way, right? And we do this because we do this not because, you know, we expect ourselves to lose, right? Of course we want to win. Of course we don't expect ourselves to lose. But at the unforeseen event that we do lose, that we do get hit, right? We can be protected. We're not going to get wiped out, or we're not going to lose a lot of our monies because we did our risk management, right? And remember, minimized losses are way easier to regain back rather than large losses, which are either, you know, hard to gain back or hard to sell because you're going to be in denial that, you know, you didn't lose this much. You think that the stock's going to go up still, right? And so that is basically the FTSR. And I'm gonna move the floor now to BJ.
Okay, thank you for that, Lance. So now that we have the hard part done, it's time to get on to the fun stuff. So first, we're going to start with learning the mechanics. So like any game, for you to start playing, you have to understand how to play. So I broke this down into three parts. So first, we have to prepare the right equipment for you to join the stock market. Second, you have to learn the terminology. And last, we're going to look into how you actually execute things. Okay? So first, the equipment. Next slide, please, Lance. Okay. So learn to get the right equipment. So first, a brokerage account. So there are a lot of brokerage accounts here in the Philippines that are available to you. So one of them is called Financial, the number one brokerage in the Philippines. It's
not active, so really?
So there are actually a lot of other brokerage accounts available to you depending on what bank you have. But then Call Financial actually does not require you to have a specific bank account. So Call Financial is very good. So for a brokerage account to open, you need a TIN number or a valid government ID and accomplished forms. So that's all you need for you to open a brokerage account. Next, of course, the starting capital. So if you opened a Call Financial account, the minimum capital you need is 1,000 pesos. The maximum capital that you should put in, it's according to your comfort level. But imagine it this way. would you learn how to drive driving a Lamborghini or a Mercedes? It doesn't make sense for you to start out with an extremely large sum, but then it's really up to you at the end of the day. And lastly, external resources. So for the external resources, you need charting software. That's for your technical analysis. And you need research platforms like PSE Edge. That's for your fundamental analysis. So you can use Investigrams or PSE Edge. But again, Call Financial actually has fantastic charting software and research platforms. So you know where to go. So next, now that you have the right equipment, you have to learn the terminology. So know the terminology. So like any game, you have to know the terminology so that you can trash talk other players. Just kidding. Okay, so I broke this down into the 6 most basic and most used terms. So that's the ticker symbol, VAR, liquidity, entry, exit, and cut. So first, the ticker. So this is an abbreviation used to represent a company. So Jollibee is JFC, Ayala Land is ALI, SM Prime Holdings is SMPH, and I want you guys to take a wild guess at what BDO is. All right, so next, VAR or value at risk. So this relates to what Lance was talking about earlier about risk. So this is the total amount of money that you are willing to lose in a trade. So at any given trade, no matter when things go against what you think are going to happen, this is the amount of money that you're willing to lose. Next, liquidity. So this is basically the amount of shares being actively traded at any given time. So a highly liquid stock means that there's a lot of supply and demand going around the markets and a lot of people are trading it. So the bottom row refers all to the execution of a trade or an investment. So the entry is the price at which you decide to buy a stock. So you buy at, let's say, 210 pesos. So you enter a stock at 210. Next is exit. That's the price at which you decide to leave your position and sell a stock. So that's either selling it for a profit or selling it at a loss. Okay. And then a cut is particularly selling a stock at a loss in order to stop the bleeding. Okay. So next, we can look at how to execute. So this is a snapshot of the Call Financial charting software. Very clean, very slick, very profesh. Okay. So the black line shows the resistance line that Lance talked about earlier, and the red line shows the support line. So basically, a basic strategy is for you to buy at support lines and sell at resistance lines. So below, I put an example of how you would execute this trade hypothetically. So let's say that your value at risk for this trade is 1,000 pesos, meaning if it breaks below your cut point or breaks below the support or a breakdown, like what Lance said, you're going to sell the stock and you'll only lose 1,000 pesos. Okay, we have no time, I think, but I'm going to rush through the last few parts. Is that okay? Okay, so yeah, basically that's the sample execution. So next. Okay, so this is the order page for Call Financial. So basically all you have to look at is these three boxes. So that's the board lot. Okay, just kidding. We have a lot more time, so we can chill. So again, yeah. So these three portions are what you need to look at for the execution page. So first is the order details. So here you click whether you want to buy or sell a stock. Next, you input the number of shares you are going to buy and the price at which you want to buy it. Next, you have to look at the bid and ask columns. That's the one in the middle. So the bid column shows the number of people who want to buy a stock. And then the ask column shows the number of people who are going to sell the stock. So basically, for this example, at the top row, you can see that there are 28 people who want to buy 15,850 shares of Jollibee at 207.2 pesos. The same thing on the other side. There are 30 people who want to sell 11,770 shares of Jollibee at 207.4. Okay, so that's very important for you to look at when you're going to make a trade, because if you want to buy, for example, here, 40 shares at 210, you're going to end up buying 40 shares at 207.4, because that is what people are selling it at and not 210. And the last part that you have to take notice of is the board lot. So this board lot, unlike the US, in the Philippines, when you trade stocks, you have to buy in increments of a specific number. So for example, Jollibee has a board lot of 10, meaning you can only buy in increments of 10. So 10, 20, 30, 40, right? So there are other companies that have board lots of 100 or 1,000. So you have to look at those before you make your orders. So next. Okay, so next is important tips and tricks. So like any game, it's more fun when you know the cheat codes, right? So the first one that we're going to look at is the game plan. So this is an example of what we do in our jobs for every trade. So first you have to formulate your trade. So formulation for your trade includes knowing your entry, your exit, and your VAR. So if you remember, the entry is the price that you're gonna buy the stock. The exit is when you're gonna sell the stock if it goes your way and it goes up, and also where you're gonna sell if it goes down and it doesn't go your way. And of course the VAR. So like my example earlier for the sample trade, you know that for that trade, you would lose 1,000 pesos if the stock breaks down. Okay, so knowing all of this before the market even opens is very important because it gives you a set plan. So all you have to do is execute, which is part two. So in the execution phase, all you have to do is follow the plan. So you have to keep it mechanical. So it's important to keep it mechanical so that it takes away the emotions that Lance was talking about earlier. You become more logical and more rational and less emotional. So staying consistent with a plan is how you're going to make it out of the stock markets profitable. And be patient, stick to your plan. If things don't go your way and it doesn't reach your entry price, don't buy early and say, oh, I'm trying to get in early so that I can earn more. No, stick to your plan. Okay, step three is the review phase. So did you follow your plan? What could you have done differently? So everything that could have gone wrong, did you prepare for that? Everything that could have gone right, were you ready for that? Okay. And the last step, of course, is to make use of this review and refine your strategy. So you make improvements to your plans so that your next trade will be better than the last. Okay, now that you have a game plan, the next step is for you to, next slide, to pick stocks properly. So this isn't very intuitive, but also Lance explained earlier that for situations like the pandemic, if you only broke down the business models, you would be able to know which stocks would most likely go up. But for the picking process, I do recommend to stick to the FTSR framework, which is the fundamentals, technical, sentiment, and risk. Next, you should stay up to date with disclosures. So disclosures include anything that the company announces. So that's all public information that could affect the stock price in the short term and the long term. So examples of this are financial statements releases, either quarterly or annual, acquisitions, partnerships, everything about the company that could potentially affect the business are public knowledge, and you should stay up to date with these. And lastly, follow the flows. So flows is actually another terminology that I didn't include, but basically flows refers to the volume or the liquidity that's going into a company or out of a company. So that's the inflows and outflows. So people who are buying and also people who are selling. So it's important to look at the flows because the more people who are participating in a stock, the better chances you have of actually buying and selling and also for the stock to move. Next, pandemic specific advice. So this is a little too late for COVID-19 as you saw with the charts because everything that crashed either stayed up or recovered already by now. But the good news is, well, the good news and bad news is that this isn't the last crisis that you're going to experience in your lifetime. So yeah, that's dark. Anyway, so some tips that you can learn from this pandemic is that you should focus on the narratives. So we can see companies like Cebu Pacific and companies like PLDT. So PLDT went up because it fit the narrative of a pandemic. And then Cebu Pacific stayed down because it wasn't able to cope with the pandemic. Another tip is for you to be prepared. So once the next crisis hits, you should know what you should do based on your experience now. So based on what happened today, you can adjust how you approach the stock market the next time a crisis hits. And lastly, again, stick to the framework. So I know it may sound repetitive, but sticking to the framework is actually very important and will be the difference between being successful in the stock market and not being successful in the stock market. Okay, so now that you have everything, there's a lot of resources out there that can supplement your trading. What Lance and I discussed today is fairly the tip of the iceberg. I know it sounds cheesy, but it's really not. When you go into the stock market, you can't always expect to win, and you don't really go into it to lose, right? So with every trade, I hope that you remember that it's not about winning or losing. It's about learning and becoming better after the next trade and after the next investment, right? So win or lose, it's the school we choose. So yeah, thank you.
All right, grabe, holy. You know, I feel like my brain just grew like 1,000 billion%. Feel it nga, Aaron?
Oh my God, Mark, are you Justin Bieber? Why you keep saying holy, bro? But for real, that talk made me so hyped and ready to try investing in stocks myself.
Same, Aaron, same. So thank you once again, DJ and Lance, for that very wonderful and insightful talk. And I'm sure everyone here has learned a lot. Actually, me nga, I learned that actually there's two tools that you could use to invest in stock. There's the funda analysis and the technical analysis. What about you, Aaron?
Ako naman, I guess I learned how lots of factors affect stocks. So you're gonna have to look at the narratives talaga, like what our speakers were repeatedly stressing over a while ago, in order to be successful and take the appropriate course of action. But now let's hear from our audience members. If anyone has any questions or clarifications, please do send it in the Slido link that will be sent in the chat box below. Remember to use the code hashtag stonks, that's capital S, and all the other letters are small. Yes.
Yes, that's correct. But so guys, just remember, you only have 15 minutes for this. So, you know, grab the opportunity and, you know, don't be afraid to shoot your shot, Yon. All right.
Yeah. If you guys want also, you can just PM Mark and then he's going to put your questions in the Slido link for you.
All right. I think it's, we have our questions here na Aaron. So the first question is, what is a good amount of money to start investing with for us college students? And how much did you start with for any speaker?
Oh, okay, I'll answer that. That's a good question. What's a good amount to start with? I forgot to mention it earlier, but there's like an unwritten rule that we have for the Philippine market. It's that every trade should amount to greater than 8,000 pesos. That is because there's a commission, a set commission that the PSE and your broker takes from you every time you make a trade. And below 8,000 pesos, it's at a fixed rate, but above that, it becomes variable. So for you to make the most out of each trade, it's best to keep your trades above 8,000 pesos. But in general, for a good amount of money to start with, it's really up to you according to your comfort level. So if you take into account the 8,000 peso rule, maybe around 25,000 should be fine so that each trade isn't like the majority of your portfolio.
Okay, thank you so much for that. Second question, can you apply as a trader for Cedarside or Calum if you are a fresh graduate? That's for any speaker, pala, sorry.
I'm not sure actually, but I know Call Financial has internship programs that you can apply for, and based on what they see, maybe they can take you if you apply as a trader in their company.
All right, thank you very much. So yun daw guys, yes, you heard it from the man himself. But third question, this one I'm actually curious about this din eh. Can you invest though in foreign stocks? And if you want to add on, you know, any answer, yes, feel free.
Yes, you can. You can open. I know there are brokerages here, such as Interactive Brokers or Ameritrade, which you can apply for, and you can start trading international stocks using these brokerage. But Call Financial doesn't have the option for you to invest, or even local brokerages doesn't have an option for you to invest in foreign stocks.
Okay, so for our next question, what are other resources that you'd recommend to start learning how to invest and or trade?
For learning resources, actually everything's in Call Financial talaga. The YouTube page of Call Financial actually has like full lessons. They have a lot of playlists. They have like several technical analysis playlists, also fundamental analysis. And they break it down very well. And it's knowledge coming from very experienced traders and investors. So if you like watching videos, if that's how you learn, I do recommend going to the Call Financial YouTube page. If you like reading, there are a lot of books also out there that can supplement your learning.
All right. So for this next question, I feel like it would be better if both speakers answer. So yon, what's the biggest mistake that first-time investors make?
I think it's really the emotional part, right? Right. The first time you make money in the stock market, you think that, oh, you're so good, that, oh, you're gonna make it, you're gonna make more again next time. But the markets will humble you all the time, right? And from that point, you'll understand that it's not about a one-time, big-time jackpot in the stock market, right? Which is why the FTSR framework is very important, because we understand that it's not about, you know, winning that job, the jackpot, but it's consistently winning, right? And by that, we expect ourselves to lose, right? But of course, we minimize our losses. And so yeah, every day, there's opportunity for you. You're going to learn that this always an opportunity for you to earn money or to gain money, right?
Just to add to that, so for me, I agree with Lance. I think Lance saw me go through this stage also, my major mistake. I think this was first year or second year college when I just started. Lance and I just started, and there was one position that I held through for a very long time, even when it was clear that I should have sold it and cut my losses. But then, you know, as a starting trader, I was set on, no, this stock, I studied it, it's good, it's gonna go up. But, you know, almost a year later, I was just saying the same thing, and then it finally hit me, you know, you're wrong. So just cut your loss. So if I learned that earlier, I would have cut it way, way, way sooner. So yeah, the emotional part is probably the biggest downfall of both starting traders and or investors, and also seasoned traders as well. So keeping your emotions in check is probably the best thing that you can take out of this.
Okay, thank you so much for that. Next question, what are the benefits of trading over investing in less risky funds such as funds?
I'm sorry, can you repeat that last part again?
Okay. What are the benefits of trading over investing in less risky funds such as index funds?
Well, usually for index funds, you would want to invest in it, right? Especially if the index fund you're talking about are emerging market index funds, right? Like, for example, a Philippine index fund. You would want to invest in it because you believe in the growth story of the Philippines, right? A Philippines is a developing country, which you think would become a developed country one day, right? Which is why investing would be good for index funds, if you're talking about index funds, right? Trading index funds might be a waste of time, but depending on the fund you're talking about. Yeah.
Just to add to that, yeah, I agree with what Lance said. So if you guys look back at what an index fund actually is. It's a collection or a basket of goods. So for example, the Philippine index is the top 30 companies that are meant to represent the Philippine market as a whole. So for example, you don't know much about, let's say, Indonesia. You don't know the companies in Indonesia, but you do think that Indonesia as a whole has the potential to grow. So instead of picking out a random company and hoping like this is the one that will go up out of all of the companies, you invest in the index so that you basically ride the entire move of the whole market. So yeah, it's a little bit safer if you don't give in the time to research particular companies. And yeah, like what Lance said, especially for emerging markets, you can get better returns investing in index funds.
All right, all right. So for the next question, this one, it says, what can you say about the renewable energy industry? So I think it means like parang, what can you say about investing in that industry?
Well, I think it depends on the market, on where the renewable energy company you're talking about is. For example, if this company is in a country like Japan or the US or Europe, wherein they've already set a target year for like non-renewables to be phased out, right? It's better to the renewable energy environment there would be better, right, than for example in the Philippines, wherein the priority is not yet in renewable energy, right? Because we're a developing country and we need factories. We're gonna burn through a lot of like coal and non-renewables for our country to develop. So for non-renewables here in the Philippines, it's certainly at a very early stage. You're not gonna see a lot of really big development, especially once that would be fully supported or fully focused on by the government, right? But again, renewable energies are, you know, the future of world development, and so you know it's good if you keep an eye on it.
Yeah, I agree with what Lance said. Renewable energy, especially here in the Philippines, it's very far from taking over. Unlike in the States, especially with the recent presidential election, if any of you follow, you know that they're trying to shift to renewable energy as the main source of power. So that's why a lot of renewable energy stocks have been soaring in the States. But then the States is a very different beast from the Philippines, especially since we're not as developed. You can't expect us to get on the trends as fast as the States or even European countries. So yeah, I love renewable energy. Like, I love the environment and all, but for the Philippines, I just can't see it happening in the near future.
Okay, so for the next question, so one of our viewers wanted to ask if, like, the thought process on investing, whether or not you're gonna invest in a stock.
Wait, again, sorry.
Oh, sorry. One of our viewers wanted to see if you guys can go over sample analysis again. So basically your thought process on whether or not you're investing or not in a particular stock.
Okay, I can go first. I think Lance and I are very similar how we do it. So looking back to the FTSR framework, so we go through all four. So fundamentals, so for example, you find a company, you're like, oh, this looks interesting. So for example, Jollibee, you see it's chart and you think it's a good time for you to buy. So you check the fundamentals. So you read up, what is Jollibee? What's its business model? So knowing the business model helps you know the potential for growth, its earnings, how it's doing. So overall, the quality of the company. So once you know the fundamentals, you can assess whether it's a good opportunity to invest or not. So like if you research a company and you know that it's not making any sales, it's not earning money, there's really no point to invest unless it's highly speculative, like with potential for earning a lot in the future. So it's very case to case. And then for technical analysis, maybe Lance can explain this one.
Okay. So yeah, maybe we could continue with Jollibee, right? You know, if you like a company like Jollibee and you think its fundamentals are great, it's like it's the best you've ever seen, right? Technical analysis should help you whether it's the right time for the stock to be bought or not, right? If people in general, remember we talked about support and resistance, and if people in general are feeling a bit, feel that prices of Jollibee are a bit overvalued, or, you know, it's very expensive at this point, right? You would generally want to step out on the sidelines for now, even if you think that the company fundamentals are really good, right? And so you use technical analysis mainly to time your entry and exit points. But choosing a company, it's really based on fundamental analysis.
All right. So for this next question, would you go through mutual funds instead to be safer or to be diversified? And what is your strategy in this situation? Because I feel like lots of people are kind of scared, you know, investing and stuff.
Okay, that's a fair question. So the thing about deciding whether you want to invest in individual stocks or ETFs or mutual funds, again, it's all about your comfort level. So yeah, you're right. Mutual funds are a little bit less risky. So if you're comfortable with that. And also, it all depends on the amount of time that you're willing to give. So for example, if you have the time to look at charts and dig into financials for a significant amount of time, I do recommend stocks because the potential returns are really outstanding. If you're a little more pressed for time and you just want to make investments for your future, for your financial freedom, mutual funds are also better than the usual rates that you have at regular banks for savings accounts. So again, yeah, it's all about your comfort level.
Okay, thank you so much for that. Next question, is it a good or bad time to start investing given the global pandemic?
It's always a good time. No, yeah. Yeah, there's the thing about the stock market is you're never too late to join the party. Like even if people have been posting like my portfolio is up 100%, 200%, it's the stock market doesn't stop. And no, just kidding. That's not wrong. That's wrong. It doesn't stop going up. No, that's wrong. It just doesn't stop giving you opportunities. Okay, so there's always going to be a new innovation in the stock market. There's always going to be a company that outperforms. There's always going to be opportunity for you to buy an upcoming company and ride through its whole growth. So is it a good time? Definitely, it's a good time. So don't be scared to join. Like, there's nothing that you missed out on, but there's a lot of potential for you in the future.
All right, so thank you for that wonderful answer once again. So the next question is, what are your responsibilities as an equity analyst? What skills are necessary if someone would want to take up that job or profession?
Well, first of all, you have to be, I think what you need is really that intuition or like that feeling whether a company is good or not. Right? And for you to be able to do this, you need to be you need to have financial knowledge, right? Because you're going to be reading a lot of financial statements and looking at the business model or financial prospect of a company. And so that's the first thing that you need. And second thing is you need to be able to do a lot of research. Right? It's going to be a lot of reading through you know, company presentations, earning call, and basically just reading up on them, right, with whatever they're doing.
Okay, thank you so much for that. For the next question, what US stock would you invest in right now?
What US stock would you invest in right now? That's a bit difficult to say. There's a lot. It's crazy. Maybe we can give you like our favorites. Maybe. For me, I like my favorite stock right now is Grow Generation. If you're familiar, if anyone's familiar with that, GRWG. So do you want me to like explain why I like it, or you just wanted to know the pick?
I guess why also, so that we can like have an idea of the thought process behind it.
Okay. So this company kind of came up on our radar of early into our employment. It's basically a retail, a chain store for particularly for hydroponic growing or modern farming, if you're familiar with that. So they sell everything that you need to start your own farm. So that's both commercial and industrial farms. So why we like it is its financials are very good. Its earnings are growing very rapidly, and its margins are also very high. So those are all of the boxes that we want to check out for us to determine whether a company has very bright future and potential for growth. And also because, like I said, I love the environment and I love the whole trend for modern farming. I think it's very important that we shift into this more sustainable mode of farming, especially with the lack of resources, the dwindling water, and the, yeah. Basically, I can start a whole conversation about that, but that's the gist of it.
All right. I'll see you. Go.
For me, it would be, two of my favorites are NVIDIA and AMD, because you have a growing data center of economy, right? And then there's also the potential of Bitcoin becoming a big thing again in the near future. And these two companies are very well positioned in the industry, because they really hold a lot of the market share, or are gaining a lot of traction with regard to the market, their market share. So yeah, those are my two favorites.
All right. So for the next question, do you guys have your own code that collates information or posts from traders and from stonks, and is it okay DAO to ask for it?
Own what? Sorry.
Oh, so the question is, do you have your own code that collates information or posts from traders and from stocks? And is it okay DAO to ask for it?
Own code.
It's like I think search engine that gathers. Yeah.
Oh, no, we don't have that. We're tech illiterate. Nah. No, basically our process for screening. I think that's what the person's referring to, how we find stocks, I guess. We start off with a technical screen. There are websites that do that, because we do foreign stocks, so there are websites that do that. But for the Philippines, I mean, there are just a handful of companies. It's easy to just look through every single chart. I think me and Lance, we look through hundreds of charts every day to find potential investments before the market opens. So is there a way to do that faster? I mean, with time, you get better at it. You can look through charts faster. And then again, you have to go through their fundamentals as well. So we don't have a code. Sorry.
Okay, thank you for that. For the next question, we really have so much questions coming in because all our viewers are very interested. So next question, which company is best to buy stocks from?
Wait, sorry. Which company is best to buy stocks from?
In the Philippine market or?
I guess it's in the Philippine context because it wasn't really specified, but the US one was already answered a while ago, so.
Well, again, it really depends on your strategy, right? Whether you're a trader or you're an investor. For a trader, there's basically a lot of options for you to choose from. But from an investor point of view, a lot of companies, such as your real estate companies, they're recently gaining traction because, first of all, they're recovering. And second of all, a lot of them have plans on expanding or even making their own real estate investment trusts, or what we call a REIT or REIT, right? Which would add on more liquidity to these real estate companies. So if you're an investor, you may want to look at real estate companies here in the Philippines.
All right, Sige, thank you. So for the next question, even I'm really curious about this. So how often daw do you trade when you were in college, and how do you balance it with ACADS?
There were classes where Lance and I were seatmates and we would be looking at charts. And then sometimes hassle kasi in some the Wi-Fi is not very strong. So we would leave class sometimes. But yeah. Any chance we would get. Depends also, like, if you're not holding anything, you don't really have to watch. But yeah, it's just according to what you're capable of. And also, if you really want to do it, I mean, you'll definitely find ways to work around your schedule and make time for that.
How about for Lance naman?
Well, it's the same, but I really just focused on more on like active investing, which is like, you know, holding a stock for like for a longer time period, right? Rather than just trading, because, you know, all of you, of course, know that ME is a really tough course, and you'll go crazy if you trade and then study. Yeah, so you know, whatever fits your personality and whatever character that you choose, right, you definitely can work with that.
All right, Sige, thank you. So I think this is going to be the last question now. So is there a Robin Hood type of app here in the Philippines?
No, there's none, sadly. But Investigrams has like a social portion, so I think that's the closest that you can get to it in terms of finding out what other people think of stocks and what they're doing, particularly at any given time.
All right, Sige. So I think that's all we have, like all the time we have for the question. So thank you once again. Oh my, I am very sorry. Thank you once again, BG and Lance, for blessing us with your super solid answers and advice.
Yes, indeed. You guys have once again blown my mind. Okay, guys, guess what time it is? Workshop time. So you guys will be given data and information on 10 companies, and your job is to identify, number one, which are essential versus non-essential companies given the context of the pandemic, and number two, which is the best potential investment. So yun, very interesting. We will now be opening the breakout rooms. All of you, please click on the breakout room button that just popped up on your screen.
So yun, guys, so get ready for a very fun, exciting, and merry-making breakout activity. So see you after 25 minutes. So Aaron, you want to sing us a song?
No, I'm already being invited to the breakout room pre.
All right, so guys, see you there. Perfect. Time for me to buy a jowa.
No, bayan, Mark, parang di naman binibili yun. But anyways, let's all take a picture to commemorate this wonderful moment.
All right, yes. Okay, everyone, please turn on your camera so we can see those very wonderful, stunning, guapo, beautiful faces. Yon. Ba malay nyo, like nandito na yung the one for you. All right.
Okay. Bro, kadyo.
All right, guys. So, turn your cameras
hey, everyone,
on.
There's quite a few of you. Yeah, so there's actually two panels of you guys. So, can everyone hear me? Yeah. Okay, so just keep smiling until I say so. Okay, so first panel, smile. 1, 2, 3. Okay. And then next panel. Okay, hold on. Just keep smiling, guys. Okay. 1, 2, 3. Okay, thank you.
All right. Thanks, everyone, for showing off your beautiful faces. So now, I'm actually simping for all of you. Grabe, gagwapo pala nandito and gaganda. So that concludes today's session. So thank you to all the Super GV participants, you know, like na you were able to laugh at our jokes. I hope sana you did. And yeah, we hope to see you again soon. Once again, I'm Mark Phoenix D., your local, James Reed, na mukhang galing sa Bilibid from 1BSME.
And I'm Ariel Lampangan, your bobong course mate, na bobo sa buhay mo from 1BSME. And this has been the first interest-based MEAster class on Stocks and Investments 101 brought to you by HR Training and Development. Don't forget, you are supported by us. And the supported pala here is like TD, so Training and Development.
Grabe, big brain naman ang gumawa niyan. So yeah, guys, goodbye. Thank you for coming. And I hope masarap yung dinner nyo. Kasi yung sarap ni... Ay, yes, joke pala. Sir. Tolino.
Thank you, guys.
Yun yung music.
Okay, thanks, guys. I'm not